Hello, my name is Bob Swanson. I'm an astronomy instructor here at ICC, and I'm going to help to guide you through the Module 1 lab activity. This one's entitled Basic Coordinates and Seasons Lab. And if you clicked on Module 1 lab activity, you'll wind up at this screen. There will be a few more video links down below here than what you're currently seeing, but I haven't created those videos yet. In fact, that's what I'm recording right now. So when I record this, it's going to show up on this page. A couple of other things you should pay attention to on this page. The student guide. When you click on the student guide, it's going to show you an eight-page sheet or an eight-page document that looks like this. You can either print it out or just leave it on open somewhere on your web browser, because I will be referring to that during the course of this video. You'll also want to click on this lab simulation. This will actually take you to a website that looks like this. It's from the University of Nebraska at Lincoln. They have all these wonderful astronomy simulations we'll be making heavy use of during the course of the semester. So let's get right into it. In the Basic Coordinates and Seasons student guide, the first thing you need to do is you need to open the Flat Map Explorer. And again, I'm going to just go through this step by step and the student guide, and then I'm going to create a different video that will fill in some of the details and go through some more of the background. But when you open up the Flat Map Explorer, again, this is the Terrestrial Flat Map Explorer, you'll see a world map. And this world map has numbers around it. These are values of latitude and longitude. And again, I encourage you to go through the background material associated with this lab. Notice there is units of longitude and latitude, finding longitude and latitude. That will explain what longitude and latitude are. But assuming you've gone through that, I want to at least show you how to get the student guide completed. You're supposed to just pick out different locations, either the actual location or by given when you're given the longitude and latitude values, and find out what that location is. So if I wanted to find out, say, for example, the first one, the center of the island of Madagascar, what I do is I go back to my Flat Map Explorer, and I know where Madagascar is. Here it is. It's off the east coast of Africa. And you click on it, and it gives you two values. And again, this is what latitude and longitude are. These are values that help you pinpoint the location of any spot on Earth. Any spot on Earth can be located if you know those two fundamental values, what its latitude value is and what its longitude value is. The latitude value is how far north or south that spot is from the equator. So notice if I click on the map features, there's my equator, that green line. And sure enough, Madagascar is about 20.1 degrees south of the equator. Longitude is a little more arbitrary, but it is how far east or west your location is from what's called the prime meridian. And again, the background will tell you what the prime meridian is. But sure enough, Madagascar is 47 degrees east of the prime meridian. Let's see, you fill in those two values of the data table, and you're good to go. Notice that there's a bunch more that you can play around with. Notice in question 3, they ask about sexagesimal notation. This is not super important, sort of inside baseball, but the Flat Map Explorer defaults to giving you the latitude and longitude in degrees and in decimal degrees. So it gives you the location of your spot, let's say Mississippi. I'm recording this currently in Tupelo, Mississippi. We're approximately 34 degrees north and about 88 degrees west. So I'm in the ballpark. Notice, yes, I'm to the nearest 0.1 degree in both latitude and longitude. Now, each degree can be broken up into 60 minutes, and each of those minutes can be broken up into 60 seconds. And that's what sexagesimal refers to. When you click on the sexagesimal, it will give you my latitude not in tenths of degrees, but rather in degrees and then minutes. So I could also say that Tupelo is 33 degrees 56 minutes north, 88 degrees 13 minutes west. Notice that when I switch back and forth, at 33.9, that's pretty close to 34. And 33 and 56 minutes is pretty close to 34 degrees as well. Notice that 56 minutes is close to 60 minutes, just like when you think about time. You know, 56 minutes is almost a complete hour. Likewise, 56 minutes is almost a complete degree. 33.9 degrees equivalent to 33 degrees 56 minutes north. And likewise with the longitude. Again, sort of inside baseball, not super important for our purposes. Question 4, they want us to play around with what's called the Globe Explorer. Now that we know what latitude and longitude look like on a flat map, let's play around with a sphere. Let's see what it looks like. So go back, we click on Globe Explorer, and now we see, instead of a flat map, we see a globe. And again, you can move your location around anywhere you want on the globe, and you'll get the latitude and longitude values. By clicking and dragging, you can also change the orientation of your globe to see different parts of the globe. You can put on some cities, you can show some of the features. Again, there's the equator, there's the prime meridian. You'll also see the international dateline shown here. And again, I encourage you to play around with that at your leisure as far as the background material goes. Okay, moving on. Now, we're on to page three, and we need to learn about celestial coordinates, because in astronomy, we're not dealing with what's happening here at the Earth. We're looking at what's happening in the sky. And so for the sky, if you wanted to pinpoint the location of a particular star in the sky, it would be nice to be able to give coordinates just like here on Earth. In order to tell you the location of any spot, you can just tell somebody the latitude and longitude. Same thing with the sky. It would be nice to be able to pinpoint a star and say it's got a certain pair of coordinates, which would help anybody to locate it, not just, you know, the observer, but if you wanted to share that with a friend or tell somebody halfway around the world where the star is that you're interested in, you can give them those values. Well, you can do it, and you do it using what's called the equatorial system. Okay, and this involves these two coordinates called right ascension and declination. And I'm going to go back into the celestial coordinates area again. You're more than welcome to read the background material. I'm just going to go straight to the flat map sky explorer to talk about. Actually, I'm going to go into this little simulation, which is similar to what you'll have access to. Notice now we're seeing the Earth on the inside of a larger sphere. What we do in astronomy is we pretend, and it's not really true, but we pretend that when we look up at the sky in the night, at night, we see all these stars, we're going to pretend that they're all essentially little dots on this big sphere that surrounds the Earth, and they're all essentially located right on that sphere. Now, that's not really true, but from our perspective, that's the way it appears. And it comes in handy in specifying the location of stars. So we pretend that all these stars are located on this sphere that surrounds the globe. And we can then use some of the information from our globe to define points on the sphere. So for example, when we look at the globe, we can see there's the equator, what's called the geographic equator. Well, if we project that outward onto the celestial sphere, we get this green line called the celestial equator. In fact, I'm going to put the label on there. Celestial equator. There's the equator. Here's the celestial equator. Again, that line that goes around the middle of your celestial sphere. A couple of other things to note. Notice there's a little black line coming out of the top of the Earth. Well, that's the geographic North Pole, where Santa makes the toys, right? And likewise, you've got another little nub at the bottom of the Earth. That's the geographic South Pole. That is the axis that the Earth spins on. Every day, 24 hours, it spins once on its axis. Again, that axis is made up of the geographic North Pole, geographic South Pole. Well, if you extend those poles outward and have them puncture the celestial sphere, you get what are called the North and South celestial poles. Okay, easy enough. Now, that helps us in determining what's called the declination. So if I have a star, let me go ahead and put a star right there. I'm going to shift my, you can move your globe around just by shifting and clicking. Notice that my star is located above the celestial equator. And so if I wanted to pinpoint the location of the star, I could tell somebody, well, just look 26.8 degrees above the celestial equator and you'll find it. That's terrific. That's what's called declination. Declination is very much like latitude. Remember, latitude is how far north or south you are of the equator on the Earth. Declination is how far north or south you are of the celestial equator in the sky. But notice there is a problem. You can't just stop with declination, because if you tell somebody to look for a star at 26.8 degrees declination, they can choose any star along this little gray circle. All those stars have a declination of 26.8. So I can move this around, 26.8 over there as well. That star would have the same declination. So we need a little more information. One thing before I move on to the other piece of information, I should point out that declination, very much like latitude, can be either above or below the equator. Now, in geography, when we talk about latitude, we usually talk about north latitude or south latitude. In astronomy, when we talk about declination, when we're north of the celestial equator, we talk about positive declinations. In fact, they go from anywhere from 0 all the way up to 90. The North Pole, the North Celestial Pole, also known as the star Polaris, has a declination of positive 90. But they're all positives when you're above, when you're north of the celestial equator. When you're talking about stars that are below the celestial equator or south of the celestial equator, we don't necessarily say south. We typically call those negative values. So any star that is south of the celestial equator is given a negative declination value until you get to negative 90, which is the south celestial pole. All right, I'm going to continue this video on the next video so it doesn't get too long. We'll see in a few minutes.